I'm a co-founder and CTO of E2E Networks, and someone who has been working on free and open source for a very long time. I started my stint in Anna University, NRC FOSS, if you guys would have heard about it. So that was where I started and learned my ropes, and we've been doing this for 7-8 years now, and done a lot of scaling and stuff like that. So quickly moving on to the agenda of the day, and the first thing I wanted to convey is how difficult it is to get something on the cloud which works, which scales, and it seamlessly scales at any point of time without getting hands on dirty with the underlying technologies of the cloud. And a lot of vendors have tried to make life simpler for a lot of customers, as in like people have started building like a lot of ecosystems around their public clouds and so on. So while that may serve as a quick getaway for you to get your POCs done very quickly, in the long run, it has its own certain challenges. So unless you understand it fully and navigate it correctly, you can potentially have a bit of a challenge in scaling up and so on. And one of the biggest thing is the interoperability on the cloud. So essentially, your workloads cannot be guaranteed to run across the clouds and so on. So there's no standard, there's no interface, there's no API gateway of sorts where you can just pipe in your workload into an interface and it runs across multiple clouds, nothing like that. And of course, Gartner is there. They again have a survey they have found out that the vendor lock-in on public clouds is one of the key concerns for a lot of players out there. Now, what we are trying to answer and probably ask a few more questions myself is to how to do this scaling without essentially being hampered in any way by the underlying technologies and essentially be portable enough and be stable enough to be able to do this. And let's look at the overall concern for a lot of people with cloud agnosticism. One of the big challenges with cloud native is that when you have really large deployments, you cannot control cost. So that is some of the challenge that you have. Because you have a challenge in essentially being able to do spending like a lot of cost, because once you start scaling, the underlying resources potentially become infinite in the sense that they spin up like a lot of instances and you're not able to control your cost at a very reasonable data point. So there has been like quite a few studies on how to get this balance right, and of course any cloud native services, including that which is provided by AWS or GCE or anything, there are some absolutely critical stuff that probably no one can avoid to some extent, and we figure that you should be able to still do that. But then what we also want you to do is essentially be able to convert the rest of the 80% of the cloud native infrastructure into a standalone cloud agnostic infra, which essentially runs multi-cloud. So you could essentially go to a dedicated server provider, someone in the US, and try and get those bare metal boxes up along with your container workloads across different locations and so on. So typically there has been like a lot of studies. I am not quoting those papers actually here, but you can potentially see savings of up to 40% is what a lot of studies have proven just by going cloud agnostic with a minimal of cloud native. Now, just going back to this, let's cut out this entire cloud native and cloud agnostic stuff. Let's get into the actual technology on when to scale, how to scale, what to scale, right? So that is the most important questions. Of course, I think in this day and age, this slide should be redundant, that everyone knows there's an equivalent for every service out there, right? It's just that there is some time and effort involved in getting that done. So name any technology for any cloud native service, you obviously have like an open source and a free and open source equivalent. For example, you take Lambda, which is one of the sophisticated pieces of engineering, you have IBM Best. So that point is new. So you have all the technology in the world for every cloud native services that are available. So let's get back to the most pressing question of the day for me. So what do you scale? When do you scale? And why do you scale, if at all that matters? And it's also important to understand what cannot be scaled, right? One of the biggest mistakes that we all make is that we essentially assume everything is scalable, which cannot be farther from the truth for anyone who has seen production workloads and massive amount of traffic coming in when there has been, let's say, exponential traffic raise and so on. So you could go viral, you could get on Reddit in just a matter of minutes. Some celebrity could tweet you and they bring in like a humongous amount of traffic to your site. So you need to be prepared for that. How do you do that and all? Those are the questions we wanted to answer. So first things first, one of the key challenges is to how to get the right box, right? If you do not have the right box, no matter what kind of scaling technology you have, it will fail, right? So it will fail. No matter what kind of containerized microservices you have, no matter what kind of auto-scaling groups or your app engine, everything will fail. Simply because you do not have the bare minimum idempotent unit which can run that request on its own, right? So the first thing you need to define is what does it take for my application to run a particular request. Let's say 10 requests have to serve. What's the minimum unit of compute and memory and whatever IOPS that I require to run that? Unless you solve this question, it's not wise to start scaling, right? So that is the first thing you have to do. And you also have to overcommit on a per box basis. And this is like, again, you have to do some statistical analysis to find out how much do I overcommit keeping my overall budget in mind. But typically what I would recommend is 20 to 30% overcommit on a per box basis actually helps, right? The reason is it's actually so good to get carried away by the term called scaling that you stop making all these decisions. See, no matter what technology you use, there is still an inherent latency in getting that new node up, right? Go to AWS, go to GCE, go to any cloud provider, Azure. There is still a finite latency. You talk to their architects, they will actually recommend that you give some buffer times just to get the node up. And even let's say you go so fast and say, okay, look, I can spin up like 1,000 Docker instances in no time. But that still takes time, right? You can spin 1,000 instances. That's like the most easiest piece of infrastructure code that you can write. But there is still a finite microsecond latency and you cannot sacrifice your users for that amount of time. So it's still very, very commonsensical to make sure that you have overcommitted on a per box basis to just ensure that you have that buffer till your backup plan kicks in, well, whatever array of technology that you have written and code that you have written to take care of that scale. So it's very important to that. And network planning is again super important. So I cannot emphasize this enough. People make mistakes here. I've seen like people under-provision bandwidth. I've seen people not set up the NAT gateway the right way and so on. So how many of you know Atlassian HipChat? Some of you might have heard about it. So they went down massively because NAT gateway bandwidth was low, right? Something like that happened. Of course, you not know the true extent. This is what they shared as an RCA, but you cannot overemphasize the network setup to be right, right? I've seen like people set up encryption between VPCs, right? That's so ridiculous, right? VPCs are anyway supposed to be encrypted. So those are the kind of stuff that you have to get it right before you even scale. So this is why I have this case. Make your siting decisions, make your network decisions right so that you're not sacrificing. Even when you scale, you should be able to absorb those traffic. Now, the traditional model of scale tells you that you need to monitor a lot of metrics from your monitoring system, set up very, very fancy data pipelines, Kafka, all that, and monitor every metric that you can possibly can. But that cannot be farther from the truth, right? So you have boxes with load averages of 10 and 15 running very, very smoothly without any challenges because the number of cores itself are like 72 cores and so on. So who cares about a load average of 15 anymore, right? So you need to get the actual data that counts. And for an end user, if you talk to a business guy
in your organization, he will tell you that the browser error where someone sees something going wrong in your website is the single biggest differentiator for the user, right? If the average page load times are high, the users bounce. If there is a fine out for, you get tweeted out on a major sale that cannot be good publicity at all, right? So the fine out X errors and the page load times, and surprisingly, people still haven't figured out the TTFU problem in this day and age. That is still true. So we think, look, using all sorts of caching mechanisms, using like, let's say your Ajaxify request, using your request response cycle in which you don't do any data lookups, you solve the TTFU problem. But if you look at still the major sites, they still have that problem. The time to first byte is still on the higher side. So these kind of things should be your triggers to scale, right? Not the typical monitoring metrics. So you should have more attention being put into fine out twos, fine out fours, fine out threes, and all this stuff, preferably Elast alerts with ELKs and so on, which can pump in notifications whenever they see a pattern of high load, high latency, and so on. So that is the most important thing. And again, this is one of the big questions that you have to answer. What is the mode of scaling that you want? Whether you want a proactive method where you essentially say, look, there is a huge sale going to come in, and I'm just going to over-provision all my instances by a factor of one or factor of two, right? Just double my instances. I can get over the sale, but the unit economics is not going to help, right? So you inherently assume like a lot of stuff here. Like, for example, you assume that there will be latency in getting new instances, right? No matter what kind of technology you use. And you also assume that there will be some warming up problems. See, no matter what speed you spin up a node, you still need to spend some time in getting it up to speed, ensure that some of the caches are built and so on, and before it can be actually predictive. Otherwise, what happens is the more nodes you add, you end up exponentially degrading your existing customer experience. So that is one of the challenges of scaling. You will end up making the problem more bad than what you started out to actually fix, right? So that has to be, you have to assume all these things, right? And typically this, you have to have this massive segregation in your architecture on what is scalable and what is not scalable. Once you have the determination, you should be able to answer this very easily. And basically, like, again, you make that slightly machine learning stuff where you can set up your data pipelines, assume rapid provisioning using containers, where typically, like, in less than let's say a second, you have a new container, and do like a probabilistic offset where you always have 20% spare capacity on containers. Anyways, you are overcommitting on CPU and RAM, so you should be able to afford that much of overcommit on your containers. And have newest data pipelines, like, forget about those monitoring alerts which come in with respect to your, let's say, your Nagio, Zabbix, and all that. Those don't help at all. That's one single piece of advice, if you like, that I would like to say here. Don't trust them, right? Trust the newest data pipelines. Look at your ELKs, look at your Prometheus's, your Grafana's, and so on. They are making much more sense. Sensu is again making a lot of sense today. And it's also interesting to understand what cannot be scaled. For example, your DB, no matter what kind of help you have, you cannot scale that, right? That too, in an instant, if you can at max add a few slaves, basically like delay the actual onset of the big problem, but you cannot solve the DB challenges just like that. It would require patience, it would require like a lot of re-architecturing, do a lot of sharding. Even if you have to do, let's say, multi-master replication without your UUIDs in your application, you cannot do that on the sky. One fine day your product engineer comes in and says, tonight I want this master-master replication, does not work, right? You will be in serious soup if you think you can get away with DB scaling like that. You cannot do that. So it's important to understand that these things require patience and planning. Right? That is it. If you understand that, then you're fine. Right? And again, network setup, like I told you before. So we had seen instances where someone was actually getting bottlenecked on DNS lookups because they were doing like millions of lookups to update their customer apps with location data for their own regions, weather data for the customer's region, and so on. Millions of requests per second, the DNS got choked, and the entire infra was fine, right? So then we had to set up things like Unbound and so on, which are like, which can do millions of requests per second without a sweat, right? So those are the kind of things that you have to benchmark, run siege and stuff like that to ensure that you understand what you have to do. And this is how a typical cloud agnostic infrastructure looks like. So you have like a lot of incoming, everything is terminated on the firewall and the HFProxy basically. You essentially have, you run HFProxies, right? That should be the single entry point, right? Anything else fails, right? First thing I always say, run HFProxies. No matter what kind of traffic you have, it is a stateless traffic, stateful traffic, UDP traffic, whatever it is, just TCP traffic, just run it HFProxy. It takes care of connection management. That overhead is taken off. That's the monkey off your back for the application, right? So once you do that, it's just essentially building simple microservices using even bare metal or your Dockerized infrastructure. For example, I would say the bottom layer here, this typically goes into your pre-provisioned machines with good IOPS and so on. And this top layer, of course, this is like a simple web and API kind of a setup. But the more complex it gets, the more microservices you have. And this is what typically is stressed in a typical high scale-up scenario, right? If you have a major issue in this layer, then you need to go back to your application, right? That cannot be scaled. Inherently, it cannot be scaled. Although you can manage by doing over-provisioning, set up massive systems, people set up 1 terabyte RAM boxes, just load everything onto MySQL. You can do those strategies, but it's inherently not scalable unless you spend that kind of dollars to tide out whatever traffic that you have. But the good scale problem is here. If you are able to, So basically the good scale problem is here. If you are able to convert all your scaling challenges to this layer, then you have done a great job, right? If anything else is kind of there, then you essentially need to re-architect your application, figure out what to be done and so on. And this is a slightly low-res resolution. So this is again that big segmentation I was talking about. So you want some part of your network where you want absolute reliability, no major changes, nothing will change, nothing can be changed randomly, because these are critical pieces of your infrastructure. For example, your WAF deployments, your firewalls, or even your major DB deployments and so on, this cannot be changed. Sorry if I have to read this out. Low rate of change, high cost of change, and low tolerance for disruption, right? Changing DB scale, to a sharded mechanism or a master setup mechanism, it's not going to be without its own downtime, right? And how much downtime you can afford on a production environment, that's always a subject to question. And the app specific network or the app part of it is what you need to be having maximum agility with. High rate of change, low cost, and you can potentially have high tolerance of disruption, because all these are essentially of the paradigm no single point of failure, and every instance or a container is a throwaway instance. You lose one box or one rack full of servers, you should not break a sweat in your scaling challenges. That is the entire idea behind designing an app-specific network which is of high agility, right? And how do you get this balance done is, again, there are some very specific open source tools. Of course, there are other competing open source technologies very similar to this, but this is something that we have had very, very good results with. And it supports like all the container orchestration platforms of today. For example, Kubernetes is, I don't want to flame anyone here, but it looks like that's the one slightly ahead in the race, right? Although Mesos is also getting quite popular, but Kubernetes is something that a lot of people are betting their next gen products, as far as a lot of public cloud providers are concerned. I'm not talking about hobbyists like me and most of this in this room, but a lot of public cloud providers are providing betting their stuff on this. and it provides like a lot of infrastructure services in terms of your service discovery, where you don't have to write Ansible scripts just to add a node to the HF proxy, right? So those days are gone by. Now what you need is, the moment a node comes up, there should be auto discovery, service discovery, write the DNS names for that, route traffic to that, and automatically detect if that container or whatever goes down. So that is the new paradigm. No one is writing scripts anymore to do manual stuff anymore. So service discovery, load balancing layer, and it also provides an overlay network which you can secure using encryption as well if you want. And it runs essentially on Linux bare metals, and you can hook it up with any of the cloud. So essentially, you can be truly multi-cloud using this kind of an approach. And again, being multi-cloud, you need to be again prepared for how are you going to handle latency in your data stores across geographical regions, right? Some of the data stores are very, very amenable to cross-geographical replication and so on. For example, Mongo is something that a lot of people do. You can run on different continents and it still works very decently, but you have to be very, very careful about what data stores you choose for that kind of a cross-geographical replication to ensure that you have a true multi-cloud deployment. So again, this is Rancher also has like a good set of catalog. So essentially, you can set up like something like a Percona extra DB cluster in no time. It's just a single click, just select the number of containers you want and you're on. So you can build your catalogs, you can build your microservices approach, and you can scale it up. So what Rancher automatically does for you is it monitors the health of each and every container, which is something that Docker has solved recently, but that was a very big concern area for Docker deployments. Okay, how do I monitor my containers? What do I do if they go down? How do I write those detection algorithms and so on? So Rancher essentially solves all of them along with using a HF proxy for your health checks and so on, so that it detects if a container is under duress and kills them and restarts another container if required, so that your application does not lose sense of the overall response time. And you can integrate with your existing CI/CD pipelines, your Bamboo, JITlab, whatever it is. Right, so this is one simple multi-cloud deployment that we have. So two instances on AWS and one on Google. So these are the three containers I'm running. I'm running a Redis, I'm running a Google container and a Postgres container. If you can see this, this is actually split between these two boxes. So you can set container affinity rules. For example, you can say that this particular microservice will go into let's say Azure, this particular microservice will go into AWS or whatever, or this particular microservice will go, or this particular thing cannot even be a microservice, it will be a traditional VM and it will go into a bare metal with a huge amount of IOPS that I have, NVMe, SSDs, whatever it is. So there are essentially a school of thought which says that some applications shouldn't be containerized, right? So although that's like a very a divisive topic. So the school of thought which says everything that can run on a VM can run on a container, but there's a school of thought which conservatively says that look, everything should not be containerized. So with that in mind, you can design your application to, again, if I have to go back to this, so this entire region is going to be your containerized microservices infrastructure. So having 50-60 microservices these days for a major deployment is no big deal. People have like hundreds of microservices with different cross-functional teams like handling each one of them and so on. And this is where the most of the action is going to be when a scaling challenge happens. Okay. And this is my summary, and we should go for cloud agnostic deployments on the cloud for cost efficiency and also performance improvements, because you the moment you get deep down and into the bare metal, you have a lot of scope for further optimization and tuning. And for scaling up your app layer, our recommendation is to use microservices for doing this, and have new age metrics, like I said, not the traditional monitoring and geospala metrics. And the future is going to be any truly web scale deployment is going to be multi-zone and multi-cloud, right? You just cannot escape that. even if you don't want to, you will be forced to do that. So essentially, you have to be prepared for multi-zone and multi-cloud deployments across multiple public clouds. So that is how deployments are going to be. And I'm done.
Thanks, Imran. We have 5 minutes for, we have a couple of minutes actually for Q&A. Sure. So if you have a question, please raise your hand. We'll come to you with a mic and then you can ask your question.
Two questions I have.
Sure.
The first one is you're talking about those microservices and apps architecture.
Sure.
Right? So it's a general problem, right? As long as all my communication stays within the box pretty faster, right? Once I disintegrated into multiple microservices and running independently, then I have to hit the network bottleneck, right? So is there something that you guys have thought about, right, how to disintegrate it? Like, which is from
so
a,
so one simple ways that this congestion happens is typically you have not provisioned enough IOPS on your boxes. So a lot of the times it's actually not network bandwidth, but the actual local IOPS bandwidth that you have, which becomes the bottleneck for containers across boxes to be able to communicate to each other. And the second challenge is if containers are talking to each other directly, that's an overhead. So which is why what Rancher does and what we also do in our deployments is that every entry point to a microservice should be a load balancer, right? You should not be using one more container service to route requests to so on and so on. That should be avoided fully to solve this bottleneck problem, because HFProxy is the one you can pump in like millions of requests literally and it will not break a sweat. So every entry point into, let's say you have 60 microservices, every entry point to every microservice should be a load balancer with HFProxy. So that typically still solves the problem. But in practice, what we have done is like we deploy our infrastructure on 10 gig networks, right? And with enough IOPS on a per Docker basis, which is why again that sizing decision came to what's a good box. So in Docker context, you also have to understand what's the good box at a bare metal level, where you have to have enough provisioned IOPS, and depending upon what kind of workloads you run, you have to decide whether a low frequency processor like a 2.4, 2.5 gigahertz, or do you need like a 3.2, 3.3 gigahertz for your app? So you need to decide those things. And once you get that box and once you have those entry points in your HFProxy as a load balancer, typically works out well.
We'll speak to you later.
Sure. Let's do that.
Another is the last one which you said that multi-cloud, I understand. You also said multi-zone. Is there any specific reason you wanted to highlight multi-zone?
Multi-zone is, see, the least we want people to be able to do is at least do multi-zone deployment for DR reasons and so on. That is not escapable at all. But multi-cloud is essentially how it is going to be. And if you want to be multi-cloud, you have to be agnostic. You cannot port your workloads from one cloud to the other just like that.
Multi-zone, you generally say for application and DR.
Exactly. So that is like the low-hanging fruit. If you cannot go cloud agnostic today, go multi-zone. That will essentially like highlight challenges in your architecture on where is my bottleneck with cross geographical replication and so on, and then you can go truly multi-cloud.
Thanks.